Next, we'll take a look at the structure inside FHIR resources. In other words, the data model that underlies the FHIR specification. What are FHIR resources? They are small, logically discrete units of information exchange. They have defined behavior and meaning, which is the FHIR specification. They have a known identity and location, that is the URL where they can be located, whether it's on the server you're on or on the internet. They are a complete unit of transaction, the smallest such unit in FHIR, and they are concepts that are of interest to healthcare. They represent the 80% of data in systems as they exist, and they are extensible through a controlled process of creating extensions and profiles. The resources are the computable knowledge object that is exchanged between systems, a REST API, messages, documents, and in services. So when we explore a particular resource, they all have representation on the FHIR website. Each looks the same. And if you go to the page for a particular resource and then scroll down, you will see what is referred to as the tree representation of the resource and the data elements within it. This is the same format for each of the FHIR resources. Taking a look at the patient resource, where we have scrolled down to that tree representation of the resource, you will see the data elements inside listed in the left-hand column. This zoomed-in view has a key in the red text on the right, indicating the content of the columns from left to right. In the leftmost column is the name of the data element, starting with the patient resource, which is a domain resource, and a flag indicating that this resource has normative status in the FHIR maturity model. The third column over is the cardinality, indicating that there is a certain number of times that the element can occur in an instance of the resource. So zero indicates that the element does not have to be present. 0.1 indicates that the element can be present, but only one value can be assigned to it. And 0.** means that multiple values can be assigned to that particular element. A cardinality of 1.1 would mean the element must be present in every instance of the resource. However, in the patient resource, there are no such data elements. In the next column over is the data type, which is specified for each data element in a resource. And in the rightmost column is the description, including the value set, if there is a required value set. You will note that many of these items appear in blue text, meaning they are a link to a more detailed description of the item. Now, if we zoom back out a bit, you'll see that across the top are a series of tabs. Each resource can be represented in either XML, JSON, or Turtle, and there is a tab that indicates the difference between the version of FHIR that you are currently viewing and the previous version of FHIR. So since we're looking at FHIR R4, the R3 differential would indicate what has changed since the previous R3 release of FHIR. Back on the left-hand side, there is a tab for UML, Universal Modeling Language. If I click on that, we see the UML representation of this particular resource. And if you're familiar with the UML notation, this is the representation of that resource, including the binding of the terminology in the resource. Going back to the view of the entire resource, we're going to move to the condition resource. And I would like to point out some of the important elements and how they are represented in this resource to form a data model. The condition resource, of course, is used to represent a diagnosis or a problem on a problem list. Each instance of a condition resource has an identifier by which it can be located on a server. It has a clinical status, the next element in the left-hand column, which is a codable concept. It can have only one clinical status. It is cardinality 0.1, meaning it does not require a clinical status, but may have one. And there is a specified value set, active, recurrence, relapse, inactive, remission, or resolve for that clinical status. The next element is a verification status with a required value set for that as well. A data element that represents the category, whether it is a problem list item or an encounter diagnosis. Next is a data element for severity. And next, a code that represents the identification of the particular condition. A body site element indicating where that condition is located in the body, although that may not be specified, or it may have multiple locations, so the cardinality is 0.*. Then the subject of the condition, which either is a reference to a patient resource or a group resource, and you'll note that the subject data element has a cardinality of 1.1, meaning it must be present in an instance of this resource. So you cannot have a condition floating around that does not refer to a particular patient or cohort of patients. Here's a more zoomed in view of those data elements so that you can see them more clearly. And for each data element, there is a data type. If we click on one of those, such as reference, we'll see the detailed description of a reference, which is a normative item in the FHIR specification. So a reference is a pointer from one resource to another, or in some cases, if the reference is on the same server, the reference is actually included in the resource itself.